First Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, 17th verse. When you found it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Just three words. First Thessalonians, chapter 5, verse 17, simply says, pray without ceasing. That's it. That's it. Pray without ceasing. Do me a favor, touch your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Our sermon subject today.
I won't let hell
win again.
Win again.
I won't let hell win again. Listen, the last time that I was worshiping with you, the Lord gave me a message talking about the power in prayer. I got to be honest and tell you that this whole concept the act of praying. Something that, again, God has been placing very heavily on my spirit back in. I got to tell you, the last time I was here when I left, I got a call in there from Sister Dotson. And Sister Dotson said, hey, Byrd, I went to the movies after church, and I saw this film, and it really blessed my soul, and I wanted to see if you and Consuela had gone to see it. And I said, no, we hadn't seen it yet. My wife got a call from her mother who said, hey, Consuela, I want to know if you and Quinn have went to the movies and you've seen this film. We said, no, we had to. My mother called and said, hey, I want to know if you and my daughter-in-law have gone to the movies to see this film. I said, no, listen, I told my wife, okay, look, I'm going to take a day off work because you know when you ain't got no babysitters and three children anyway. So when I took a day off and me and my wife had a date day. And on the date day, we went to the movie to see this film. Listen, I remember growing up, there's certain films, if you will, that really stand out in my mind. I remember growing up, my grandmother didn't call them films. She would say, sit down and look at the picture show. And so I remember grandmama showing us a picture show called The Sound of Music. Some of y'all remember that. It was Julie Andrews who played the role of Maria. She was a caregiver for the 7 Van Trapp children. You remember, it was a story that when she got to the Van Trapp's house, these were some mischievous children, and they had run through several caregivers. But when she got there, we found that the reason they had done that, really because there was no joy in the home. And so what Maria did, she tapped into something that they enjoyed, which was their singing, and where there was no joy, she brought joy. Another film, y'all know I won't say, this is my last time talking about. But listen, Danny Glover played the role of Mr. Oprah Winfrey played Miss Sophia, and then Whoopi Goldberg was Miss Seaman. Now listen, that was a film that was full of verbal, emotional, and even physical abuse. However, the other part of the film simply said that if you hang on in there, there's a moment that you can overcome everything that you've been going through. All you got to do is just hang on in there. That is another film that I remember called Life. Y'all remember that Eddie Murphy played the role of Ray Gibson, and Martin Lawrence played the role of Claude Banks. They had been in prison for a crime that they did not commit. Dr. Mack, one of my favorite parts in the movie, that was the prison warden, and he had a little daughter named May Rose, and May Rose had grown up, right? But May Rose, this white woman, had a chocolate baby. Y'all ain't gonna say nothing. And so, what happened, what y'all gonna know? Act all super holy on me this morning. And so, she had this little chocolate baby, and she took that baby. The warden took the baby, and he was holding it up beside the inmates, trying to find out who the baby daddy was, right? And y'all remember, amen. Some of y'all seen the movie again.
Y'all know,
act all super holy. But there was a part in the movie where he was holding the baby up, and he got to the character called Jagalang. And Jagalang, then he moved on down, and then he got to the character, Can't Get Right. And he paused there at Can't Get Right because the baby looked quite similar to Can't Get Right. But in order to throw the prison master off, Jagalang stepped out and said, was in jail for 65 years for a crime that they did not commit. Amen. But what happened is that even though they were in prison for that long, they realized that if they hang on in there, things were going to turn around. And at the end of the movie, when they were in prison, somehow they escaped out of prison, and the movie ended with them sitting at the ball game. Listen, isn't it amazing, or wouldn't it be amazing our lives were like a movie, that in an hour and a half, all the hell we've been through can be turned into matter. Amen. Just of sitting out in the movie theater. Don't we understand that life isn't like that? But let me tell you about this movie that we went to go and see. We went and we sat there and we got our nachos and our drink and we prepared to watch the film. What we did not realize is that it was going to touch us as much as it did. That was our old sister on this film named Miss Clara. Miss Clara was about to sell her house and she met a young lady named Elizabeth. And when she met Elizabeth, she was walking Elizabeth around the house telling her about her. I don't want to spoil it for anybody. Let me just give you the quick version. She said, Elizabeth, the first room I want to show you is the sitting room. She said, this is my third favorite room. Elizabeth said, well, what do you do in this room? She said, mostly just sit. And she moved on. She said, listen, I want to show you my second favorite room. Her second favorite room was the dining room. She said, I got so many fond memories in this room because me and my son would have dinner and have conversation in this room. And then Elizabeth said, well, what's your favorite room? If the sitting room is your third favorite and the dining room is your second favorite, Miss Clara said, let me go ahead after the next day. She said, look, it's time for you to see what my favorite room is. Miss Clara went upstairs in her house. She went into her bedroom, and when she got in her bedroom, she opened the door to what you and I would look at as a closet. But Miss Clara said, no, this ain't a closet. This is a warm room. She said, look, it's in this room that he would argue it completely differently. Dr. Jackson says that hell is any place where the spirits of evil and forces of darkness can cause havoc and confusion. If Dr. Jackson is correct, then wherever there is confusion, wherever there is spiritual darkness, wherever those two things are happening, hell is on the loose. If that be truthfully told, you can have hell on your job. You can walk up and there's a lot of confusion, gossiping, and maligning of each other. You can have hell in your family. Am I talking to anybody in here? You can have hell in your marriage. You can have hell in your checkbook. When you look and say, now I know I ought to have more money left. Maybe that's just me. More money left in this. You can have hell in your mind. The devil can get in your mind and have you confused. The devil can put hell in your heart where you just won't forgive people, holding on to malice and all of that. You can have hell in an emotional state. The enemy will make you want to commit suicide and throw in the towel when God is trying to tell you that your destiny is still ahead of you and that you're going to be greater later. Ladies and gentlemen, listen, wherever the forces of evil and darkness causes confusion, you are in the midst of hell. The late Bohemian prophet Dr. Miles Monroe wrote in his book, The Purpose of Prayer, that prayer is an earthly license for heavenly interference. Wait, listen. Prayer, he says, is an earthly license for heavenly interference. In other words, he says, look, prayer is a privilege that God gives all of his children that allows us to put heaven where hell used to be. Y'all got that? Okay, so watch this. Look. Heaven and hell cannot exist. Why? Because one will ultimately dominate the other. So every time you want to move hell out of your way and put heaven in your view, then you've got to learn how to do one thing and one thing well. That is, you've got to learn how to get to your war room and begin to pray. Are y'all with me this morning? Look, I heard a story not long ago of a lady, a sister. She called her pastor and she said, "Pastor, I need you to pray for me. There were some horrible things going on in her life. She was having a horrible time with her husband. She was going through a horrible time with her family. Her baby son was dropping out of high school and things were crumbling all around her." Is that anybody, amen, you've been, amen, facing a time when, amen, it seems like every time you try to put one foot forward, the enemy knocked your 5 steps back. And I'm not talking to anybody in here, but look, not to make matters worse, but this sister's job was failing, and they were laying people off by the dozens. And so she telephoned her pastor and said, "Pastor, I want you to pray for me. But look," she says, "I want you to pray that I don't let hell win again." I thought that was just the most wonderful prayer request, because every now and then, you don't know what you're fighting. You don't know what a battlefront is. And so Sister Girl said, "Look, I don't want you to pray for my marriage. I don't want you to pray for me. I don't want you to pray for my son. I don't want you to pray for my job. I want you to pray that hell never wins again." So look, free will, here is my declaration for your life, for your walk, for your witness, and for your worship. I pray this morning that hell never wins again. I pray that your walk says, "Yes, I'm in warfare, but hell won't win. Yes, I'm in the fight of my life, but hell won't win. Yes, I'm in a battle right now, but hell won't win. Yes, I'm trying to get to where God wants me to go, and I'm even under attack every single day. But here is the shout of the morning. If you hang on in there, you can declare, you can shout that hell will not." So watch this. Paul here, in our lesson, Paul is writing to the church at Thessalonica. They were a weak church, but they were growing strong. Did you hear what I said? They were a weak church, but they were growing strong. And they're growing strong not just because of inspiration, they're growing strong because of information. It was the information coming from the Word of God that was giving them the right inspiration. They were weak, but they were growing strong. So in chapter 5, look, Paul says, if you got a good man of God, take care of the man of God. Why? Because he feeds your soul. Can I pause real quickly and tell you this? Whether you are a member of Free Will or not, or perhaps one of our guests, whoever your pastor is, you take care of the man of God. Don't you let people talk about you. You don't let them talk about your children. You don't let them talk about your mama. And for God's sake, you ought to every now and then have some righteous indignation and say, "You got one time to say, 'Son, by my pastor, I swear to God, I will kick you.'" I'm sorry. I know he don't tell me don't do that. I'm y'all here. Don't want to do that. Listen. But you got to take care of the man of God. Why do you take care? He feeds your soul.
So look, Paul says, take care of the man of God because he feeds your soul. But listen, not only did he say, watch and take care of your man of God, but he says, learn how to take care of each other. Listen, because listen, I ain't gonna give them any amens on this part. We don't have time being jealous and envious and hypocrisy and backbiting. We ain't got time for that. We ain't got time fighting each other. Why? Because we got a real enemy on our hands. Do you not know, amen, how much power the church would have if we learn not, amen, to be at separation, but if we learn how to band together? Don't you know you can get more accomplished together than you can apart?
God is leading church folk, raising more saints. Look at what Paul says. Paul says, he gives these commands. In verse 16, chapter 5, he says, rejoice evermore. Ladies and gentlemen, if you can't do nothing else, learn how to hold on to your joy. He then goes on in verse 18 and says, and in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. If you can do nothing else, you don't need to let a complaint come from those lips of yours. But you learn how to say thank you. Whether it's in the midst of stress, duress, and mess, he said you gotta be able to tell God thank you. He said you gotta lift your hands and say thank you. Whether you're on the mountaintop or in the valley low, you gotta tell God thank you. Whether you got a job or you're looking for a job, you gotta tell God thank you. You gotta tell Lord thank you for what you got until you get what you need. He says, tell the devil in hell, I won't let you win again. Ladies and gentlemen, this is my declaration for your day. It is my pronouncement, amen, for your life. It is my prayer for the rest of your journey until you leave this earth, that you don't let hell win again. Don't let hell have your family. Don't let hell have your marriage. Don't let hell tell you your son or your daughter has a sexual misidentity. Don't let hell make you shut up because you don't have enough money. Don't let hell make you fall while y'all ain't saying nothing. Don't you allow hell to win your mind. Don't you let hell put you in a state of depression. Don't you let hell have any type of discretion. Don't you let hell have any opinion of you. You stand firmly and tell
when I know that If you're going to make sure that hell never wins again, you're going to have to pray. Here's the text. Pray without ceasing. Listen, it's written in the present tense. It's written in the imperative move. In other words, it's in the active voice. What are you talking about, Byrd? It's a military command. Y'all with me? You know, some of y'all been in the military. You know, up 10, clap, you know, butt rain, breath, left face, right face. They're not asking your opinion. That's a command. Paul, this great apostle from Tarsus, says, if you gonna win the battle against the enemy, here's what you gonna have to do. I ain't asking you, it's a command that you got to pray without ceasing. I ain't got no more. Start to pray. It's because when you would pray more, if you could see more what's happening when you do pray, you pray more. Now look at the Bible. Let me tell you this. When you start praying, which is panic. Okay, let me talk to this real quick here. When you start praying, demons tremble. When you start praying, even though you may not see it, God gets that attention. Okay, let me talk. Okay, these are seasons. When you start praying, stuff starts turning around.
Ladies and gentlemen, listen. That's why if you got children, you need to lay hands
The book of 1 Samuel chapter 1, the Bible said Hannah had been praying for a baby. She was trying to get pregnant, but she couldn't, and Peninnah would vex her soul. The Bible says one day while she was eating dinner, she had enough. The Bible says she got up from where she was and she went to the temple and she began to pray. And she was praying so strong and so fervently that the priest thought she was drunk. Listen to me carefully. Every now and then when hell is breaking loose and you're tired of hell winning, you refuse to let hell win again, you've got to pray until you mess up your makeup. You got to pray every now and then until you come out of your boat. You got to pray every now and then. You got to pour out your heart until you begin to feel the Spirit of God moving. Okay, let me hold you. So point number one, you got to make prayer a practice. Not only do you make prayer a practice, but if you're not going to let hell win again, check out the text. Number two, write this down. You got to make prayer perpetual. Write it down. You've got to make prayer perpetual. Listen, people who shout, shout. No matter where they are, they in the mall, they shout. They in church. Mess around with your Zoo Lily at justfab.com. Shout and shout. Golfers golf. No matter where you are, I was on a plane a couple weeks ago and I was talking to a brother and he said, he's on our board of directors with the bank and he said, look, my meeting don't start until 2 o'clock. I said, brother, it's a 6 a.m. flight. He said, yeah, I'm going to the driving range. I got my golf clubs with me because he's a golfer. Golfers golf. You walk in their office, they got to put range in their office no matter where they are, what they do. Golfers golf, bowlers bowl. Regardless of where they go, that's what they do. They bowl. Prayer warriors. When you see, you wondering if they're talking to themselves. No, they're doing what prayer warriors do. Prayer warriors pray. They pray like shot for shot. They pray like golfers golf. They pray like bowlers bowl. People who pray don't waste time gossiping. People who pray don't waste time worrying. People who pray have a habit of making prayer perpetual. Here it is in the text, look, pray without ceasing. Look, this is beautiful because the word here is a dialetos. Hear me out. Pray without ceasing is one of the most beautiful Greek phrases in the Greek language. The Greek phrase, a dialetos, literally means to refrain from whooping cough. It is a word that describes the involuntary activity of the physical anatomy. To do what it does without you telling it to do. Are y'all with me in here? Like right now, your eyes blink without you telling it to. Right now, your heart beats without you telling it to. Right now, your kidneys cleanse the bloodstream without you telling it to. Your lungs breathe without you telling it to. Your pancreas secretes insulin without you telling it to. The involuntary activities of the body that do things without you telling it to. Like the heartbeat, Paul says, you ought to pray. You ought to pray like your lungs breathe. You ought to pray like your eyes blink. You ought to pray like your kidneys cleanse. You ought to pray like your pancreas secretes. You ought to pray like your liver metabolizes. Paul says, you ought to pray like your body functions. You ought to pray when you feel like it. You ought to pray when you don't feel like it. You ought to always love prayer all day long. You ought to make the devil so sick in hell, and you ought to make heaven so happy, because praying is what you do all the doggone time. Do I have at least 2 or 3 witnesses in here who will say, Byrd, I can pray without ceasing? Listen, I'm going to hurry up. I'm going to rush to a close, but I got to tell you this little story. So in the morning time, my wife usually, y'all sit down. In the morning time, my wife usually takes the children to school, right? And so we've tried to instill in the kids, amen, the importance of prayer. So we let them go around and pray. And usually, when Gabby and Jeremy pray, amen, They say a little nice, sweet prayer. It's quick, boom, fast. We know it. Lord, or when Bryson prays. Bryson got to pray for everything. Lord, I thank you for the bird that was flying in the sky. Thank you for the red light, Jesus. Thank you for the green light, Jesus. Thank you that mama go to Jesus. Thank you that mama go to stop, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for the man holding the stops. I thank you for the red light. I got so doggone tired one time, I said, Bryson, just stop. I pray. But listen, the Holy Ghost quickened me one day and said, if you learn how to pray like he prays,
this one. Amen.